sounds different because, first of all, I guess I'm not the first purely academic speaker who doesn't have a big company behind, but then I'm going to talk only about perception. Hopefully, relevant to all of you driving, I will talk about motion estimation, about energy-based models, learning, and what they can learn from. So, motion and geometry estimation, autonomous navigation, why do we need it? Well, one simple answer would be to say, if you look at Andreas's great work on the Kini benchmark, these are the number three disciplines that a computer vision researcher can repeat in. That'd be a simple answer. A harder answer might be, we've heard from Amnon earlier, it's about the long tail, and I would argue that motion estimation has some relevance in addressing this long tail. Yet even though in motion estimation we've come a long way in the last three decades, it continues to remain hard. And one reason is tough imaging situations like saturations, spectral reflections, or even tough spectral highlights. But that's only some of the few problems. So if we were to design an ideal algorithm for motion estimation in autonomous navigation, what properties should we have? Well, first, the simplest one is accuracy, right? That's obvious. It should give us an accurate estimate of the motion, but that's not all. It should also be fast. We wanted to use it in a real-time system. But I'd argue, and this is a point that we've heard from several speakers in the morning, robustness is an important component. And by robustness, what I specifically mean are really two things. One is you want it to cope with data that's not exactly like what you see in a training time. You want it to be able to cope with a variety of different settings, and we've heard this in talks this morning. And the other issue that we've talked about briefly this morning, I think it was an Ingmar's talk, the algorithm should know when they don't work, because that happens, right? Amnon talked about the, 95% that perception they get, but are we now in 95 or in 5% case? And that we would like, I would argue, like to know. So if we look at the dominant families of algorithms in motion estimation, we can divide them into two different pieces. Classical energy minimization techniques on the left and deep learning pipelines on the right, as they've been popularized in the last few years, also for this task. In classical energy minimization, you formulate an optimization problem for this temporal correspondence estimation, consists of a data term that makes sure the data fits the model that you hypothesize in some regular lines. Deep learning, obvious, you take in two images, you get out a motion estimate. And what are the pros and cons along these three design dimensions that I've mentioned? Interestingly, this is sort of one of the cases I would argue in computer vision where the difference between classical techniques and deep learning techniques in terms of accuracy is not as great as in many other areas of vision, though deep learning techniques have some advantage in terms of that. But they really shine in terms of speed because they're inherently real-time capable, whereas iterative optimization at test time is basically no-go, it simply takes too long. But I would argue, at least in terms of robustness, classical energy minimization techniques have some advantage still because they tend to generalize a little bit better to unseen domains. They only have very few parameters, whereas deep learning pipelines are often tend to fit very much to a specific scenario that we've given it at the time. But in both cases, the systems tend not to know when and where they fail. So what I want to do in the following is first talk about how we can improve the accuracy of classical energy minimization techniques, then use some of these insights to actually make deep learning more robust to domain shift. And then I want to talk about robustness both in the classical energy minimization setting and then in the deep learning context. So let me start with the standard way of estimating motion from two or more images. One problem area that they tend to suffer from are occlusions, which you see here in the bottom. So by the way, this is a color-coded motion field in the forward direction on the left and in the backward direction on the right, along with the estimated occlusions. And by the way, this is joint work with two or four. So what I would argue is that occlusions tend to continue to be a key problem area in motion estimation. And part of the problem is that we have this chicken and egg relationship with the motion field itself. If we knew the motion field, estimating the occlusions would be easy because they're a consequence of the motion. Yet, to actually estimate, but if we knew the occlusions, then we could estimate the optical flow better. But somehow, Most techniques separate these and don't estimate them together. And to illustrate this, let's look at the standard pipeline to solve this problem. You treat occlusions as an outlier and try to filter it out in a post-processing step. So what you begin with is my cursor. So you take in your two subsequent frames from a video, you feed it into an asymmetric flow algorithm, get a forward flow field, and then you flip the order of the video sequences or the video frames, feed it into the same algorithm, and you get a backward flow field. And only where they're consistent forward and backward direction, there you're pretty confident that you do not have an occlusion, and in any other area where you don't have consistency, you fill in the gaps. But that's, I would argue, a post-processing technique because it's not inherently built into the algorithm. So what we would like to do is include occlusion estimation into the whole pipeline and do everything in a temporally symmetric way so that forward and backward in time is not privileged in any way. And the key benefits of that, from our point of view, is that we can resolve some of the dependencies between motion and occlusion estimation, and we don't need any of this post-processing anymore. So I don't have time to go into all the details. Most of the formulation is relatively standard. The interesting things are now these two additional terms that we use in the objective. The one here on top, or on the right here illustrated, is the so-called forward-backward consistency term. And the idea is if I start somewhere in the first frame, I move forward with the predicted motion, here represented as a homography, I end up at a new place in the second frame, P prime. If I take the backward motion there and I'm going back into the first frame, if my motion is consistent, I should end up in the same place. If it's inconsistent, then I get some distance here and I'm penalizing that. Okay? Yet, I can only do this in regions where I'm not where I don't have occlusions. So I need to bring the occlusions into the mix. But estimating them actually turns out to be hard because I somehow need to tightly interweave that with the flow estimation. And the way we achieve this is with this so-called occlusion-disocclusion symmetry term. The idea is in the explicit state representation, we have a binary indicator that indicates whether we have an occlusion in one temporal direction. And then we compute from the flow disocclusions in the opposite temporal direction, and we enforce the fact that a forward occlusion needs to be consistent with a disocclusion in the backward temporal direction and vice versa. And if we add that into the objective, and then we turn the optimization crank, about which I can't say much here for the interest of time, then we actually get fairly accurate results, both in terms of motion and in terms of occlusions. I apologize for it being relatively small here, but you see some results on the Kitty benchmark. Left is ground truth, which is sparse in this case. Here you see forward flow, backward flow, and occlusion in forward and backward region. And what you can see is that the occlusions seem to fairly accurately follow the outlines of the moving objects in the scene. And if we actually look at the motion estimates, numbers, details are probably not so relevant, we find that this very classical formulation, by now bringing occlusions into the joint estimation, actually performs near the top of the KD benchmark. And actually, all that without employing any learning yet, I should say. But we find this quite surprising because we're actually able to perform at the level of the latest deep learning pipelines with this standard, I would say, 1990s, 1980s type formulation, of course, with significant enhancements. But what can we learn from that for deep learning? So I mentioned earlier that we have one problem in deep learning for optical flow, which is this sensitivity to domain shift. And so we've been trying to use what we've just learned about engine minimization-based optical flow to address this issue in deep learning-based pipelines for flow estimation. So what's this domain shift? Well, part of the problem is that in optical flow estimation, we don't really have gradients, or not much of it anyway. We have some of it thanks to Andreas and his efforts. But for the most part, these pipelines are trained on synthetic data, like you see here on the left, which is often done very carefully. Yet you have a certain mismatch with the domain on which you want to test, and that leads to the fact that the performance often differs quite substantially between different scenarios. And unless you're able to fine tune on the test data, many deep learning pipelines tend not to generalize all that well, at least for motion estimation. So what we wanted to do is to come up with an unsupervised, or some people would call it self-supervised, method for training deep networks for flow estimation, that we can put on top of a standard approach like FlowNet by Dosovitsky and colleagues, but we don't want to require any ground truth. All that we want is to feed in some video sequences that we've taken from some vehicle and be able to estimate motion. Now, you and colleagues in 2016 have actually suggested that one can use ideas from classical energy-based optical flow estimation to do this. And they've designed an unsupervised loss function based on the following idea. Suppose you take the two frames in, you feed them into a standard feed-forward network for motion estimation, then you get an optical flow field. Now you want to judge it on how well it works. So what you do is you backward warp the second frame towards the first, and you check how well do you actually predict the first frame from the second and the motion. And if you predict it well, then you have low data loss, and you have an additional regularizer that makes sure that your motion is somewhat smooth. Okay. But we know from 20, 30 years of research on optical flow that this is a pretty naive model. I mean, this is a 1990s style optical flow model, and we can definitely do better. For example, because we use simple brightness constancy assumptions, we don't have any occlusion reasoning, and so on. Now, if we bring all of this to the table, all of these advances that we've actually made, not only us, but the whole community, really, in energy minimization-based optical flow estimation, then we can really boost unsupervised learning of deep networks for flow quite a bit. So what we've done specifically is we have, again, a temporally symmetric treatment. So we have the same network with weight sharing, both in forward and backward temporal direction, which gives us a forward and backward flow. We check consistency, and by that estimate occlusions, and we then only apply this consistency, this data loss in visible regions, and we also have consistency loss that makes sure that we have forward-backward consistency. Okay? I'm going to have to skip the details, but the gist of it is that we can now almost avoid entirely synthetic data. It helps a little bit pre-training on synthetic data to regularize the model, but the benefits are relatively slight. The predominant bit of the training has been done purely on video sequences taken from a driving car, specifically in our case, kiddie car. So how well does it work? Well, compared to previous baselines in unsupervised networks for optical flow, we get a significant improvement. I don't want to explain all this in detail. It would probably lead too far. Most relevant is probably the error plot. We want it to be as blue as possible, and you can clearly see that the error here is quite a bit lower than in the baseline on the left. Okay? In numbers, about 50% lower. And the interesting thing is, this, even though we don't need any ground truth, is among the leading methods for optical flow, despite the fact that we don't actually need any supervision, which I find quite encouraging. But I haven't yet talked about the domain shift, so let's look at that. Interestingly, we can outperform supervised networks by quite a margin. Unless we have data to fine-tune the supervised network, then of course that helps. But if we don't have that, which in many cases we don't, then the unsupervised method can really give about a 50% benefit. Well, here it's a little less, but significant benefit over networks that are trained in a supervised fashion. So that's quite encouraging. But on the other hand, we have to really address this issue of robustness. And so that's what I want to talk now about in the second bit of my talk. The other mention of robustness that I made, which is when does the algorithm work and when does it not work? Okay. So this work we call probe flow, where we don't just want to estimate the optical flow field, what we see here on the right, but we also want to estimate an uncertainty map, shown you on the left, where red is uncertain and blue is highly certain. And so why would we have this in the first place, right? In the first place, we have it because the evidence, the quality of the evidence varies across the frame, and also, of course, across time, across set scenarios. Across the frame, for example, because in highly textured areas, it's easy to estimate motion, whereas in not very textured areas, it's hard. Right? And if we have such an estimate of uncertainties or reliability, or whatever you want to call it, we can use it as a cue in later pipelines for later pipelines in the processing. We, for example, use it for motion segmentation, and there it turns out to be quite helpful. So how can we do it? I It's a bit involved, so I only want to spend really one slide on it. So we did it first for standard energy-based optical flow techniques, and there the idea may seem trivial, right? You apply probabilistic inference. It turns out that in practice it's not quite that easy. We need to do a few steps to make that possible. The first thing is that we need to reformulate all the robust penalty or robust cost functions here using Gaussian scale mixtures so that we can apply variation inference in a more straightforward form. And then we're ready to reinterpret the energy or cost as Gibbs distribution. Okay, so far so good, that's pretty easy. But then if we were to apply a standard variational inference tool like mean fields, from which we get an approximate posterior that then allows us to assess the uncertainty, we actually find that in practice this doesn't work. Okay. But actually whoever has worked with optical flow would not be surprised. Why? Because if you just apply your standard energy minimization toolbox that you've downloaded from whatever repository you have to your standard optical flow energy, you will find that it doesn't work. People have spent 20 years developing custom optimizers and all kinds of algorithmic tricks to actually squeeze accuracy out of these optical flow pipelines. And we found out that if we apply mean field out of the box to this probability distribution, it similarly doesn't work. So what we did is we tried to translate these algorithmical innovations from the energy minimization world into the variation inference world. And they translate more or less one-to-one. And once we've applied them, we can actually get high-quality flow estimates along with uncertainties. Now there's one caveat. As you know, deep learning gets more prevalent, our graduate students tend to become less math mathy, so the actual derivations here tend to be a bit involved, and you know some grad students may be too lazy to do it. But it turns out we can actually avoid that as well by employing techniques from stochastic variation inference. But I don't have time to get into that. So let's see how that works. So here we have now some results. Now the central data says not autonomous driving, but I hope that's okay. On the top, we have the ground truth motion estimate, color-coded. By the way, I didn't say anything about the color coding. The hue of the color gives us the different directions, and the saturation tells us how large the motion is. In the second row, you see the estimated flow, and in the bottom, you see the estimated uncertainty mass. And you can see that the uncertain regions tend to be near the boundaries, which is to be expected, but not only near the boundaries. And we can now evaluate that, of course, quantitatively. The take-home message is that by using this variation inference pipeline, we can estimate the flow as good or even slightly better than the standard energy minimization technique, but we get the uncertainties and they tend to benefit applications like motion segmentation that we can then have as a second step. But this is energy minimization. What if you're interested in deep networks, right? So what we've tried to do is come up with a simple methodology that's as plug and play as possible to be able to get uncertainties in motion estimation also for deep networks. And so what's interesting is even though the machine learning community has spent quite a bit of effort on developing Bayesian deep neural networks, in vision they don't seem to have arrived. And part of that is because they tend to be computationally relatively inefficient. And so in computer vision, it's standard to just get point estimates. But of course, we all know that the point estimates are not perfect, and we would like to assess when they're not. Okay? As Kendall and Gall have pointed out, there's different sources of uncertainties that are relevant to our investigations, but we only want to focus on one, the so-called uncertainty here, which is the noise in the input signal, which we can't avoid, and that turns out to be quite important also as they found for practical vision systems. But what we want to do, as opposed to existing systems, is that we want to do it in a computationally very efficient way, so we don't want to have big penalties on the runtime. Test time dropout, it was mentioned this morning, Ingmar's talk is great, but you need to sample at test time, and that's slow, so we would not like to do that. So what we want is to be able to predict some notion of uncertainty. It doesn't need to be, you know, the full Bayesian thing, that would be great, but we want to keep it as practical as possible. And as I said, we restrict ourselves to aleatory uncertainty. So we have two simple realizations. The first one is really that simple. I mean, it's quite naive. As opposed to predicting what you actually care about, in the last layer, you predict the parameters of parametric density. Okay, and that, while it's so simple, it actually turns out to work. What we then also do is that we have a more involved scheme that propagates the density through the entire network. So we start with uncertainty at the input layer, that's aleatory uncertainty, and then we use assumed density filtering to propagate the information through the entire network. Now, how do we do it? Details are probably too much for this talk, but for regression, it's actually that simple. Some other people have actually done it concurrently as well. We just put a density and predict the parameters of the density, and then do conditional maximum likelihood estimation. For optical flow, we found that the so-called power exponential distribution works quite well. And the nice thing about this is that the computational and memory overhead is very low, 5%. If we want to actually propagate the uncertainty all the way through the network, what we do is that we convert every node into a Gaussian with mean and standard deviation, which we locally estimate based on a variational inference scheme. And the nice thing about it is that we get simple drop-in replacements for pretty much all components that you have in your network. Convolutions, they're linear, that's easy anyway, but also for ReLUs, various pooling layers, and so on. That has some computational overhead, simply back of the envelope. If you estimate twice as many states, it will take roughly twice as long with the same operations anyway. So in practice, we find that the slowdown, or that the computational overhead is between 2 and 3x. Right? So we can estimate, for example, to flow, but not only to flow, and here are some results. So if we train a standard flow net, where we've now used either a probabilistic output layer where we just have this power exponential in the output, or we use assumed density filtering, we find that the accuracy in terms of the average endpoint error stays at least the same or even gets slightly better, which is encouraging because we don't want to lose predictive power. And in terms of the runtime, here we have frames per second. The probabilistic output layer, almost no penalty, and the assumed density filtering has about a 3x, 2.5x slow. But if we now look at the likelihoods of test data, we find that they're significantly better than, for example, that of test time dropouts, which is encouraging because we are at the same time also significantly faster. And so I think this gives us a relatively practical way of at least predicting to some extent where models fail. And here we see some results now for optical flow. Here's input, the two frames overlaid. Here's the ground truth. Here's what the model predicts. And here we get the predicted uncertainty up, which visually is relatively well correlated with the actual error that the model incurs. Of course, it's not perfect, but there's a reasonably high correlation. You can actually also plot this correlation. I don't have this here, and there seems to be a strong correlation that we empirically observe. As a side note, we can also apply some of these techniques to classification, where we have similar findings in the sense that the accuracy is not strongly affected, but we can increase robustness, for example, to adversarial attacks. So in conclusion, I hope to have given you an overview of what motion estimation, what we can do in motion estimation at the intersection of energy-based models and deep learning. I would argue that energy-based models still have a way to go, especially in motion estimation. They still have quite a life ahead of them. But we can use the interplay with deep networks, for example, to accelerate standard techniques at test time. Yet, other way around, deep networks can also benefit from energy-based models to cope with domain shift, for example. And uncertainty estimation is something that's, I would argue, very important and possible in both areas. And so I think this is also an area where we can benefit from that. So that's it from my side. I'm looking forward to questions. Thank you.